And now we get to introduce the poet whose work we're here to launch and to celebrate. And it is with enormous joy that I get to share with you this incredible book. Now, these sheep here on the cover. Firstly, I must thank the very brilliant Billy Parker, who created the image for the cover. So if you are watching, Billy, thank you. Here's a big high five. But these are very specifically Barbados black belly sheep. Have I got that right, Mary? Yes. Who are not fluffy. They are sleek. They are full of... if you haven't spent time, and I clearly have, Googling Barbados black belly sheep, feel free to. And there are lots of extraordinary images of how much personality they've got. They look permanently slightly aggrieved and deeply questioning of the camera. But they are the most expressive of sheep and beautiful. And they inspired this brilliant, brilliant pamphlet. Now, Mary is known to many of you, and we are all here to celebrate her. But before I introduce her more formally, I just wanted to say how utterly proud we are to have published this debut collection. The first time I read it, it made me laugh out loud. Now, I'm not going to give you any spoilers, but the first poem in this made me laugh. And not the sort of like polite, slightly intellectual half laugh of a slightly witty poem, a proper, proper belly full of laughter at the first poem in this book. Really on the basis of that, I was like, well, this is definitely one for us. But then as I kept reading on, it just gets better and better and better. It has a wonderful story woven through it, a beautiful story, and a lovely narrative that you can hold on to going through the book. But it's also just packed with loads of gorgeous and witty details. It's utterly unique. It's definitely the only poetry book I've fallen in love with about sheep farming. But it's got so much heart and humanity within it. It's amazing to be able to get so much about the world into one tiny, tiny pamphlet. And I hope that every pamphlet that Live Canon publishes does that. We look for those tiny slithers of books that contain the whole world in 24 pages, 28 pages, whatever it is. And this is definitely one of those books that is so full of personality and joy and humour, such a wry and oblique look at the world, such an unusual narrative and story, and it's small and absolutely perfectly formed. I absolutely love it. I think it's also one of those debut pamphlets that just makes you incredibly excited about what's going to happen next, because it's a perfectly formed introduction to a writer's work that is going to leave you going, okay, so when's the big book coming? So in that sense, it's an incredibly exciting pamphlet to launch. Now, Mary writes and lives in London. She's a former journalist and psychotherapist. Her poems have been published all over the place, including Ambit, Perverse, Arc, Aesthetica, Under the Radar. She has a poetry MA from Newcastle University and the Poetry School. There's lots of brilliant alumni from that course. I know you're all tuning in now on the live stream, so hello. She also founded Red Door Poets. She's co-editor of The Alchemy Spoon, which is a massive and brilliant contribution to the sort of poetry ecology in terms of being an amazing journal publishing extraordinary work. And she's also a founder member of the Crocodile Collective. She's someone who puts so much into the poetry community. And tonight, I'm very glad that we all get to massively give back. So I'm delighted to introduce Mary Mulholland.
Thank you very much, Helen. It's a bit surreal to be here, but thank you, everyone. Oh, sorry, yeah. It's a bit surreal to be here, but thank you, everyone, for coming and on the live stream as well. It's just amazing. So first of all, I want to say thank you to Helen for the introduction and for believing in the pamphlet, and to all the Live Canon team, and especially to Billy for portraying the matriarch of the flock as Marilyn Monroe. I think I love the cover, it's wonderful. Thank you for my fantastic and prestigious readers. I'm so grateful to you, and you're a hard act to follow. So you and the groups you represent to me have been invaluable on my poetic journey, and a particular thanks to Simon for his keen editing eye on the manuscript. Finally, thank you to William and Shay, whose farm it is, run on organic lines, and who've trusted me to sheep sit and also let me stay at the farm over first lockdown. And of course, not forgetting the Barbados black-belly sheep, which, as Helen says, are hair sheep. That is, they're self-shedding. They're very beautiful, lively, and intelligent, as you'll probably come to realise. When I started writing these poems, I didn't set out to write a pamphlet. I was just writing poems to a background of farm sitting, then lockdown, thinking about relationship with the environment, with others, with myself, and with life itself. Later, I saw how these poems all sort of interconnected as psychogeography, the way an environment, in this case the sheep, can affect our emotions, thoughts, and behaviour and show us things. A therapist friend of mine said recently, sheep are the unsung heroes in the education of humans and our cultural development. I heartily recommend being with sheep to explore all manner of problems. So I'm now going to read a selection. The first one is The Call. I throw things together to leave, then see you like a parked car. And before I can stop, I need a farm sit sheep. Want to come? You do, and you're grinning. And I tell myself I'm interested in the way facial expression is a play of darkness and light, and how shadow gives meaning. We're old friends, and soon close to where we met as students. We pass Preseli bluestones, cross ancient ley lines. You remind me it's all about magnets. I like pushing them to their limits. When I sheep sit, it's generally just checking they're safe and they haven't escaped, or if they have, bringing them back, and making sure they've got enough food and water. But there's often a day of overlap when I arrive that I might help the farmer with more specialised work. Preparing for sheep sitting. It's no bo peep work. No falling asleep on haystacks. Leaving you to unpack, I step into shepherd role before the farmer hands over. We drag heavy metal hurdles along hard paths, get tangled in brambles. Make a pen in the field. Today it's the turn of the boy rams. They eye us with suspicion. Like sheepdogs we herd round, we circle round to herd them. In the pen they jostle together like people on the underground. The farmer grabs a leg as one leaps from reach. Docile my foot. They buck and jump like rodeo sheep. Sometimes headbutt him, wrestle him to the ground. He checks their eyes, in silence holds out a hand. I pass the wormer and it squirted into unwilling mouths. To some, he gives a shot from the syringe. My job then to let them go one by one, but they fight against freedom, as if only we know what's good for them. Wander off as if all that fuss was for show. At the start of this particular spell of sheep sitting, the weather had been atrocious, and in the morning the water would freeze in the troughs. It might also be helpful to know, if you don't already know, that sheep, having eyes on the side of their head, have almost 360-degree vision, so easily get spooked if they feel their personal space is being invaded. Lessons in shepherding. It's so wet, the sheep are learning to swim. These are not ordinary sheep, not woolly. They have black bellies. In the morning, they watch me with amber eyes and breath clouds. I clear the ice, it drops to the grass, shatters in the weak March sun. You appear, encroaching their flight zone, and the ewes scatter. Sheep make you nervous. You become the egg collector, scar brambles for nests, lock up the hens at night. These are cream leg bar, their eggs pale blue. Hen pecking is rife, feathers are everywhere. I watch a hen eyeing an egg, She jerks forward, nudges it, pecks and pecks until she cracks it, eats it. Then you come towards me, smiling, but there's blood on your lips, or maybe it's the sun. This next one. So while I find the natural world as a go-to place for inspiration, especially how it mirrors and reflects things going on for us, I'm also committed to seeing how we play out the deeper truths of myth and fairy tale in our lives. So the next one is called The Kiss. In the yard, an olive brown stone covered in bumps is skulking away. Once a man took me boating on the Thames. He wore a green tweed three-piece, a flat cap, brought a wicker hamper picnic. We saw kingfishers. With a dart of his hand, he caught a newt, slipped it into his mouth. Another crawled after me one dark night, clutched me from behind in passionate amplexus, croaking his love. And here you come, all puffed up, driving the quad as if you're at Goodwood. Oh, the toads I have kissed. So, I've just lost my place here. So this next one was around the 22nd of April, which is the time of the Lyrids. And the farm is an amazing place for stargazing. It just seems to have so much sky. And the Lyrid meteor showers peak around, as I say, around the 22nd. You might see up to 15 in an hour, but they have been known to produce rates of up to 100 an hour. But it does depend on a clear sky. I leave you asleep and creep to the yard, bare feet in boots, and the entire universe above. It's the night of a meteor shower. I'm waiting for the dazzling display of shooting stars and the lyric harp. For this night to be alive with light. But stillness comes when we least want it and only the animals stir. I flash my torch over their field, ablaze with eyes as if Ares has fallen to earth. And the silence grows, Greek chorus loud from their bleating. So much expression from just one sound. I move away humming. The sheep go quiet. What if you and I tried talking in om? One thing I find entertaining about the sheep is the way the Barbados blackbellies often in the evening like to race around the field, seemingly for the sheer joy of running and jumping, and they can leap extraordinarily high. So the title poem comes in two parts. This is the first part. I'm not reading the second part. It's called What the Sheep Taught Me. All day I have watched the ewes, trying to see as they do everything at once. I think best sequentially. It's getting towards evening. The sheep know this too. They're starting their sunset corral of the field perimeter, practicing for the national, leaping like antelope. Even the large one bearing triplets, she soars over the electric fence. She's made of spring. All those fences I could have jumped. I take a run. The shock sends me flying. When I found myself on my own again in deepest lockdown, like so many, I turned to books. So the next poem makes use of some titles that might be familiar. Rereading the Evening. The road in is not the same without you, And with all this time, I'm missing my books and order more online, stack them into columns up to the ceiling. The ceilings here are not high. Soon they will cover a wall, a bookcase on its side, and I won't need to feel guilty if I don't read them, as I'll compose stories from spines, rearrange them according to mood. Men in the off hours, two cures for love, the lost land, mad, sad, and bad. What if another life, you and love and I, split, dart, fast, joy. On the whole, the Barbados blackbellies give birth naturally and without needing any human intervention. But occasionally, problems arise and a vet might be called out. I witnessed a very sad occasion like this, and the psychotherapist in me saw a parallel with our own creative inner child. Anyway, the following poem was commended in the Winchester Prize 2020. Still life. I'm holding the ewe's head as her lambs are removed, one after another. She has the eyes of an empress. I stroke the fine hair on her cheeks as she gulps, unblinking, swallows, mouth muscles twitching, and her lips part with one bear. I recognize the pain and the sound. The lambs lie perfect and still, sculpted alabaster, a plein air artist arranging a palette, lead white, raw amber, purple, and the cadmiums, yellow, orange, red. The newborns are cellophane wrapped, inside see-through balloons. Someone will breathe life into them. They are sleeping, and when they wake, they'll jump with the other lambs. But the flies are arriving, landing on the allantois, like people crowding an accident, gawping. These sheep often have multiple births, but having only two teats may struggle. And so there are some that have to be taken away and be bottle fed. And also, like humans, some ewes have preferences and reject them. There are always some who end up on the bottle. And the following poem is about a lamb that had real attitude, wasn't very friendly, but with whom I formed a particularly strong bond. The nursery of rejects. The newborn girl shivers in her brown coat, ruby cord dangling, edges forward to be smelt, but is head butted, sense somersaulting. Her brother, near identical, is licked all over. The mother's staccato bleats as she nuzzles and he suckles. The ewe lamb stamps her baby hoof. When I force in a teat, refuses the bottle. I feel her rapid heartbeat, so much unseen. Like that experiment, proving we need love and touch. I hold her close, really close, stroke her black velvet ears. And my last poem, which was highly commended in the Rialto Nature and Place Prize this year and will be published in the Rialto, includes a sheep counting system. It's a worldwide fact that shepherds have a particular counting system for sheep. And this one I use in this poem is West Country. Hymn to Sheep. O lamb, your gentleness daily sacrificed yet muzzled, as if your ability to see everything at once helps to let life pass. Yarn, tain, tether, mether, mumph. O lamb, who yearn to be a scholar until lost by children, Bo Peep, Boy Blue. Shepherds know humans don't do well on their own. Hither, lither, dover, over, dick. O sheep, how you group gather, spin a yarn, jaw wagging, bleating, waving ears and tails, and sheepishly laugh at your own jokes. Yarn dick, tain dick, tether dick, mether dick, mumfit. O sacred ruminants, so close to humans, once mummified, valued ungulates, let me count you. I shall finger my prayer stones, will away my fears. Yarn a mumfit, tain a mumfit, tether a mumfit. O sheep, what keeps you keeping on, knowing one day that lorry will come for you? Is it just your hope that grass might change colour? Mether a mumfit, jiggif, and back to yarn. So thank you again once more, everyone, for coming. Thank you to my readers, thank you to Helen, thank you to everyone, and enjoy the book.
Thank you so much to Mary for such a gorgeous, gorgeous reading. I think that gives you some idea of the book and a whole new journey it can take you on. I mean, we all need to learn a lot more about sheep, right? It's written with wit and warmth and joy and insight. And my favourite bit of my job is getting to share new books with readers and getting to take words that deserve to be in the hands of people and turn them into books. I mean, I absolutely love books, as anyone who knows me or has ever seen my office will know. But there is no greater joy than a brand new book arriving and getting to start sharing it with people. So those of you who are at home, I know you'd be wanting to give Mary a massive high five, a hug or a pint if you were here. But if you want to do that virtually, you can send us a message over the old social media on Twitter at LiveCanon with one N, Canon with one N, books, not guns, at LiveCanon, or on Instagram at live.canon. You'll see how I messed that up there. So Twitter at LiveCanon, Instagram at live.canon. And some lovely comments have started coming in for you, Mary, already. But if you are at home, please do send Mary a massive virtual high five. Thank you so much for joining us. And now feel free to scuttle around wherever you are, and everyone who's here, scuttle around to get a drink in your hand so that we can toast this gorgeous book into existence. As you're doing that, some thank yous. First of all, a massive thank you to Live Canon's awesome Daisy, who, as you will notice, always runs the bookshop when we have live events, but she does so much more. Can we have a massive round of applause? Thank you. To the brilliant Rich from the Bedford, who is sitting up there controlling stand, making us all look beautiful up on stage, and to everyone at the Bedford for having us here in this beautiful space with the glitter ball above me. It's always a total privilege to be here in person or to be beaming out from here. So thank you to everyone at the Bedford. Thank you to our amazing lineup of readers today. It's been a complete privilege to welcome you all here and to listen to you read, to Simon, to Chris, to Alice, and to Vanessa. Thank you so much for your generosity in coming and reading for us, in celebrating Mary's book, in sharing your work, old and new. And it is such a privilege after all the, not that I haven't loved all the Zooming, but it is very, very lovely to be here with you in person and beaming you out to the world. So thank you so much. And of course, our final thank you is to Mary for her brilliant book. Now, this is where I hand over to you lot, because Live Canon is clinging on, a small and enthusiastic poetry publisher in a mad, bad world. We are absolutely tiny. We certainly don't have a marketing department or anything of the sort. So we are utterly reliant on everyone in this room and everyone at home shouting very loudly about this book. Please tell everyone about it. Please do that in every means you possibly can. That's, you know, whether that be social media, email, telling your book club about it, telling your stanza group about it, having conversations. Tell the cleaner about it when they come round, based on Chris's poem. Don't make a proposition the cleaner, just tell them about the book. And it is absolutely fine to buy, you know, multiple copies. You don't just need one for yourself. You can gift them to everybody you know. You can leave them as thank you gifts when you've been to visit people. Please help us spread this book as widely as it should reach out into the world. So if you have a glass, please raise it. I have a very unexciting glass of water going on here, but, you know, I'm at work. And please raise your toast. I think we shall toast to the sheep, shall we, Mary? So please raise your glasses to the sheep. Thank you very, very much. Those of you who are at home, we're going to leave you now. Thank you for joining us on the live stream. It's been brilliant, and we are completely committed to continuing to share our work as accessibly as possible. So we will keep live streaming everything where we can, and making sure that you can join us from wherever you are in the world. And to those of you who are here, let's continue the party and celebrate Mary. Thank you.